found by a canine unit inside the Mandalay Bay Hotel parking garage was loaded with at least 1,000 rounds of ammunition in a suitcase and the explosive tannerite in a duffel bag. Investigators are examining whether the car was part of Paddock's escape plan. Paddock's cache of weapons included variants of AK-47s and AR-15s. Sources say the entire cost of his arsenal was more than $50,000.
Yeah. There's got to be some reason with regards to this plot happening or this attack happening when it did.
Harold Suthers is a former FBI agent who studies homegrown violent extremism at USC.
These kinds of individuals don't do things randomly. And so this is a deliberate attack, a deliberate target, and an intended outcome. And we need to find out why Las Vegas, why this past weekend, and why that particular conflict.
One official said today that this is one of the most sinister things he had ever seen. Investigators said that they won't stop until they find the truth. Anthony.
Jeff Hayes, thanks, Jeff. The massacre is not being called terrorism, and some say it's time to change the law. Jim Axelrod has more on that.
Christmas with intimidation can be terrified without the cause necessarily labeled terrorism.
It is time for a variety of reasons to have a domestic terrorism criminal statute.
Currently, there's a criminal statute for international terrorism, but not domestic. Former federal prosecutor Mary McCord thinks in an era of mass casualties, it's time that changed.
Violent extremism isn't limited to Islamist extremism or extremism that's done on behalf of or at the direction of a foreign terrorist organization.
With no specific penalties on the books for domestic terrorism, mass killers like Timothy McVeigh face charges of using a weapon of mass destruction. Or Dylan Roof, who faced murder and weapons charges. But the label domestic terrorism makes the motive clear, says McCord, now at Georgetown Law, in a way that sharpens our response.
It shows the significance of this type of a crime and why it's important for it to be looked at and treated for what it is, which is terrorism. It's a crime done for the very purpose of terrorizing people.
Federal domestic terror law would also mean FBI-led investigations and the creation of deeper, wider databases to keep track of mass violence. Of course, there is a potential problem. Labeling domestic hate groups as terrorists, like Al-Qaeda or ISIS, raises constitutional questions.
That starts to get very close to the line of potentially infringing on free speech, freedom to associate and express one's views, however abhorrent they may be to others within the population.
During the Obama administration, the Justice Department considered creating a domestic terrorism statute. We asked the Trump DOJ if it could continue in the work. The spokesman declined comment.
Jim Axelrod, thanks, Jim. A new storm is on the way. Tropical Storm Nate is blamed for 22 deaths in Nicaragua and Honduras. It could hit the central Gulf Coast as a hurricane over the weekend. A hurricane warning is up from Louisiana to the Alabama-Florida border. Eric Fisher is chief meteorologist at our CBS station WBZ in Boston. Eric?
Anthony, good evening to you. Been watching Nate become more better organized and stronger throughout the course of the day today. You can see that on satellite. The center is just off to the east of Cozumel in Mexico. Winds are up to 60 miles per hour. It's moving very rapidly. North-northwest at 21 miles per hour, which means it'll close in on the Gulf Coast very rapidly as well. If we take a look at the current warnings, they include the city of New Orleans, eastward across Biloxi, Mobile Bay, then hurricane watches up toward Pensacola into the Florida Panhandle. The track takes it with a landfall just east of New Orleans and very close to the Biloxi Gulfport area tomorrow night. So just about 24 to 30 more hours over water. That'll be it. It is expected to intensify into a hurricane, bringing strong winds, storm surge of 4 to 8 feet, and very heavy rain. Then it accelerates northeast and weakens. It brings heavy rainfall along its path all the way to New England by Columbus Day. And there you see the rain totals, not just the coastal storm. With rain totals like this, several inches up to a half foot across Alabama, North Georgia, into Tennessee, Anthony, we could have some significant flash flooding this weekend.
Eric Fisher, WBZ. Thanks, Eric. The mayor of New Orleans ordered some neighborhoods evacuated, as well as a mandatory curfew beginning at 6 p.m. Saturday. Michelle Miller is there.
With tropical storm Nate heading this way, New Orleans are operating on muscle memory. Sandbagging is the first line of defense for 20-year resident Kathy Adams.
When you heard about Nate, what went through your head?
storm dumped nearly a foot of rain in less than a day. The water was waist deep in some areas. 19 of the city's pumping stations failed that day. 11 are still offline, with at least 4 feet of storm surge expected when May hits.
I know that you can see now that we are ready for whatever comes our way.
Mayor Mitch Landrieu, can you guarantee the people of New Orleans that that pumping system will work as it should?
As a matter of fact, I can. We have plenty enough power and plenty enough pumping capacity to handle those potential rain events.
As Nate bears down on the Gulf Coast, power crews are prepping for outages. Still, Kathy Adams says she survived Katrina. She'll survive this, too.
So there's no giving up for you?
No giving up. After Katrina, I want to come back home. And now this is what I'm facing again. So you can't run. You can't run.
City officials are just as concerned about wind as they are rain. And if the power grid is knocked out, that could make this pumping system far more vulnerable. Anthony?
Michelle Miller with the preparations in New Orleans. Thanks. And coming up next on the CBS Evening News, some ominous words from the president. Many wondering, what did he mean?
People wonder. You'll be wondering.
Downtown Dallas, be prepared for a huge slowdown on I-35E. Here's Randy Fuller to tell you more about it.
Yeah, that would be on the southbound side of 35E. At the tollway, two left lanes are blocked, and we're back in that backup beyond Empire Central onto 183 past Regal Row. In Richardson, southbound 75 Central Beltline, there is a stalled vehicle in the HOV. It is pretty heavy. Back to Campbell in Richardson, and then a two-car collision on the side street northbound Greenville, just north of Westland Road. Only the right lane currently is by.
We've also got some slowdowns on I-35W in Tarrant County. Here's Julian Rogers to tell you what's happening.
Well, we've had heavier than normal traffic all day because of the holidays, so we're still looking at that from Alliance Airport down to Northwest 820,
oh,
and that's
going to
be mostly traffic all the way down. Northbound,
yeah,
not so bad if you're coming from downtown, so we've eased up quite a bit there. We're pretty clean over to Western Center. Westbound I-30, about 15 minutes between Collins and Beach Street. I-20, that looks pretty good in South Arlington, with the exception of some traffic coming in from Grand Prairie from the Bush Turnpike to 360.
There's a traffic incident reported in Denton on the northbound I-35W ramp to merge onto I-35. So that's right over Oak Street. And the traffic is very heavy. That backup extends past Corbin Road. It's nearly to 2449 Vintage Boulevard. So do be aware of that. You may want to consider 377 instead.
A warm weekend, but some much cooler weather after that. I'll see you at the weather meteorologist, Jeffrey. We'll have an overnight low around 70, and the high tomorrow around 86 degrees. A weak front comes through tomorrow morning. Some slight rain chances, thunderstorm chances to the northwest of the metroplex. So just a morning cloud for everybody else. And a north wind. On Sunday, a southeast wind and mostly sunny skies can keep the temperatures to around 90 degrees. But we'll be around 94 for a high on Monday, near record high, before a cold front arrives Monday night. And that's going to bring us a slight chance of thunderstorms. And then on Tuesday, a windy day, the high's only in the mid-70s. Right now, it's 87.
Game with a few ominous words. Today he wasn't giving any clues. Margaret Brennan is at the White House.
What did you mean by calm before the storm? What did you mean by that?
You'll find out.
At a dinner last night with top military leaders and their spouses, the president made this cryptic comment. Remark comes amid rising tensions with North Korea and next week's announcement of the president's Iran strategy. He is expected to take steps that could unravel the agreement to freeze Iran's nuclear program, also known as the JCPOA. The action would be in defiance of top national security advisors like Defense Secretary Jim Mattis.
Do you believe it's in our national security interest at the present time to remain in the JCPOA?
Yes, Senator, I do.
The Iran decision is also a flashpoint with Secretary of State Rex Tillerson. After a report surfaced that he had referred to Mr. Trump as a moron, Tillerson called an extraordinary press conference to declare he was not quitting.
I have never considered leaving this post.
The White House said today there would be no firing.
Can you continue to say the president remains confident in him as Secretary of State? Can you continue to say the president remains confident in him as Secretary of State?
I wouldn't say that he's messing with the press. I think we have some serious world issues here.
Another busy day at the White House and Margaret Brennan's with us now. Margaret, the administration changed the Obamacare rules today related to birth control. What did it do?
Well, Obamacare required employer-provided health insurance cover birth control with a few exceptions. Today, the Trump administration changed those guidelines and will allow employers and insurers to opt out of that mandate based on their own religious and moral convictions. The rule change fulfilled the campaign promise by President Trump, and the administration estimates that 120,000 women may lose access to free contraceptives because of it. But some women's rights organizations say that number is actually far higher and warn that this could lead to a jump in unintended pregnancies. Anthony?
Margaret Brennan at the White House. The White House today was talking up a drop in the unemployment rate. It fell 0.2 points last month to a 16-year low of 4.2%. The Labor Department blamed the loss of 33,000 jobs on Hurricanes Harvey and Irma. A group of activists behind the first treaty to ban all nuclear arms was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. The International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons was formed 10 years ago. The treaty was adopted by 122 countries 10 years ago. The treaty was adopted by 122 countries. Nuclear powers, including the U.S., boycotted the vote. The Nobel Committee said the coalition is receiving the award for its work. To draw attention to the catastrophic humanitarian consequences of any use of nuclear weapons. The NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said the treaty does not move us closer to the goal of a world without nuclear weapons. In fact, it risks undermining the progress we've made over the years in disarmament and non-proliferation. Democrats ran today from one of their big donors, movie mogul Harvey Weinstein, after allegations he sexually harassed female employees and actors for decades. Weinstein has taken a leave of absence from his company. The Democratic National Committee and Senators Chuck Schumer and Elizabeth Warren said they're giving tens of thousands of dollars from Weinstein donations to women's charities.